I ran in today, St. Petersburg.
Helsinki does provide a counterbalance to all of this. We are talking about another town in the Gulf of Finland. And appropriately enough, well, Helsinki is in Finland. It's on the north coast, about 50 miles or 80 kilometers right north of Tallinn. So we're heading out back to the west. And Helsinki will be our next port of call. And then the next day we'll be going to Stockholm, which is located in the largest of the Scandinavian countries. And Sweden is just a marvelous place. We'll be sailing through the Stockholm archipelago for a couple of hours prior to arriving at the capital of Sweden, and that is Stockholm, the day after Helsinki. So I'll tackle both of these two ports in the next 50 minutes or so. And of course, we are once again going to the Scandinavian area. It's very similar in terms of geography to the area of Norway, because of cruising opportunities anywhere on this itinerary. We'll be going in and out of Stockholm, 4 hours basically on either side. So it's probably better on the way out, because you're probably not going to be up that early in the morning. What you'll see is, of course, a lot of landscapes dominated by forests and trees. And as someone from Northern Canada and other people who have spent some time in Northern Canada, or also parts of Maine and the Rocky Mountains, is an area of this great boreal forest, one of the two great forests on our planet. The other dominant forest, of course, is the tropical rainforest. The other lung of the earth is the boreal forest, which occurs in Northern Europe, of course occurs in Russia, and occurs throughout North America, the northern half of North America, characterizing most of Canada and Alaska. And it's the same type of forest, primarily spruce and pine with a mixture of aspen and elms and oaks and these other sorts. Very, very dominant forest types that have really characterized a lot of the industry, particularly the natural resources of the inland regions of Finland and also of Sweden as well. So you do see, in terms of industrial activity, we touched upon when we were discussing both Tallinn and also St. Petersburg. Of course, they do overlap. There was a period of the Hanseatic League, when the Hanseatic League had certain powers in the area that is now Sweden and Finland, but that was soon usurped by a Kalmar Union. That was an organization of merchants, but not German merchants that were primarily based out of what is now Denmark, and they started having presence in that particular area, although that soon started to fall apart, particularly out of Sweden. So we'll talk about that when we get into that area. With the rise of Peter the Great here in Russia, in St. Petersburg, founding St. Petersburg, of course, the access to the sea and the access of the Gulf of Finland was very, very important. And in fact, Peter the Great was so successful in his accomplishments of gaining control to lands, he actually controlled lands that now include Helsinki and include Finland. So some of the architecture that we will see, particularly the architecture in Helsinki that dates back.
Picture I feel a certain familiarity with, primarily because of where I'm in Northern Canada.
So ecologically, it's a lot the same. The people are fairly similar to Canadians in a sense as well. Not exactly the warmest people, but friendly people. Friendly people. They're not overtly friendly. They're not going to come and hang out with you and instigate a conversation. But when you instigate a conversation with them, you find that they are very, very warm and friendly indeed, and very giving people. One of the things, of course, that is associated just on the steps of there, and it just shows you that if you can get pickpocketed in Finland, you can get pickpocketed absolutely anywhere. Although certainly crime is not something that's typically associated with Finland at all. Whenever you travel around, of course, many of us do look like tourists. I look like a tourist when I walk off the ship. Easy. Of course, there's trams. Of course, there's taxis. But
as in these other Baltic areas. The taxis tend to be a little expensive. The nice train station, you're not going to really want to take the train anywhere out of town, but just to see the architecture, the old architecture of the train station. And then a very nice, quaint, easy day. Nice and easy. You don't have to worry about language barriers. It's easy to get around. People are very friendly and nice. Little on the pricey side of things, but what isn't on this chosen destination of yours? Everything that we will be experiencing. Some of those wonderful aspects of the modern way that the people in the Scandinavian countries do things. You know, they're well known for being world leaders in innovation and design. Stockholm certainly features that. Certainly a lot of historical legacies that we saw in St. Petersburg from their palaces. Well, you'll see examples of those sort of things here in Stockholm as well. So it has a little bit of everything in a small group of countries in the Scandinavian region. And as a result of its status, it really symbolizes so much of this area. When you think of Scandinavia, you think primarily of Sweden, and does really represent them politically as well, and as their mindset. And really what it does very well is it serves as an intermediary, both geographically, of course, on the land between the West, you know, probably symbolized by the United Kingdom and England and France and Germany, and then the East, which of course would be Russia. So politically, of course, it is a little bit of a leftward lean, kind of socialist country between the capitalists. For 12,000 years or so, following the retreat of the glaciers, they still started scratching symbols and paintings on the rocks, particularly in the border country between what is now Sweden and Norway up in that area. Famously, of course, the most famous people were the Vikings in this area that dated from the 7th century all the way till about the 11th century, spreading this Scandinavian culture far and wide and spreading Christianity far and wide as well, bringing Christianity to places like the United Kingdom and Ireland and other places, and attempting to bring it all the way to the New World, all the way to Iceland, Greenland, and even a short settlement on the island of Newfoundland, which is now in Canada as well. Again, the Hanseatic League being in this area for a little while, but usurped primarily by this Kalmar Union that was based out of Denmark. 1397 was when it was first established, and it really was a united voice for the Scandinavian countries, and in its day, because these Scandinavian countries, including things like Denmark, had control over Iceland and Greenland in terms of a geographic size, my goodness, it represented a very large chunk of the world through the 1400s. Things rotten in Denmark was a pretty big deal. Well, in the 1500s, Sweden and the royalty of Sweden started pulling away, wanting to untie their ties to Denmark, and King Christian II from Denmark really wanted to put an end to it, so he paid a visit to Sweden and immediately killed the regal figure of Sweden, and then organized a meeting of the rest of the nobility, about 80 of them, and in order to dissipate any rebellious tendencies of Finland and of Sweden when we get there in the next 2 days. Thank you.